Good evening, Bahamas. Coming up tonight.
The PLP leader addresses national issues.
What's going on with the government's immigration policy? We found out from the people most affected by it.
Our news is brought to you by Alive, the nation's newest and best LTE network.
Good to be alive.
Welcome to Our News, and thanks for joining us. I'm Kyle Joaquin. Topping news tonight, Progressive Liberal Party leader Philip Rafe Davis is lashing out at the Minutes administration for what he called its inability to adequately address crime despite many campaign promises to do so. Davis, who made the comments during a press briefing at PLP headquarters this morning, also accused the media of taking the salacious route when it comes to reporting murder stats. This despite the fact that according to the last figures given by the Minister of National Security, crime was down overall. Jasmine Brown reports.
Davis claimed that much of what FNM officials spouted before the general election was propaganda, but he says they're now learning that propaganda doesn't solve crime.
You know, don't forget now, they boasted that they had the answer to crime. But so far, we have seen nothing different happening today than when they accused the PLP of fostering crime.
Davis said the Free National Movement claimed to have the answers to reduce crime, but the governing party has yet to prove it, as he suggested there may be a link between the disbandment of the National Intelligence Agency and an increase in violent crime. However, the Nassau Guardian records show that murders in the last quarter of 2017 were down when compared to the same period in 2016. The most notable decrease was recorded in November. Murders in November 2017 were down by 92%. There was only one murder in November 2017 compared to the 13 murders in November 2016. In September, National Security Minister Marvin Dames revealed in Parliament that crime was down overall during the first 8 months of the year. But overall, there was an increase in murders in 2017 compared to 2016, as there were 123 murders for 2017. That's a 10% increase in murders over the 111 murders recorded in 2016. While Davis acknowledged that the pace of murders slowed dramatically in recent months, he said other categories of crime have persisted, including armed robberies.
On the one hand, yes, you see a downward trend in murder trending downwards, but then you're seeing an uptick on armed robberies and other things. And so how do you assess that? When under our watch, we were able to demonstrate that crime was in fact going down, right? The press and yourselves allowed the murder, which was a bit more sexy, I think, to bury the advances made in the other aspects of crime.
The PLP leader also insisted it was a mistake for the FNM to dissolve the NIA. In opposition, the FNM called on the Christie administration to introduce legislation to govern the NIA amid concerns of domestic spying, but it generally supported the objective of the institution.
We cannot underscore enough the importance of intelligence gathering in our national interests and protecting against any potential threats to our country. The FNM instead followed the foolish propaganda lines of the campaign into government, as they seem to have done almost all issues.
As it relates to that U.S. advisory that was issued last week, Davis said it must be taken seriously. Davis labeled the government's response to that latest advisory lackadaisical.
We think that the government has to be proactive in seeking to find out why they believe that, and eliminate the causes. They ought to get proactive and ask the U.S. government, why do you believe that they need to issue advisories in the nature that they have?
Reporting for Our News, I'm Jasmine Brown.
Residents in shanty towns in southwestern New Providence were tight-lipped about whether there was any change to the government's handling of immigration matters. This after the Minutes administration set a December 31st deadline for all undocumented migrants to become regularized or leave. Jared Higgs visited a few shanty villages today and filed this report.
Those migrants who are here illegally must leave by December 31st, 2017.
Those were the words of Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis back in early October when his administration pledged a tougher approach to apprehending undocumented persons here in the Bahamas. A few days after the policy deadline, Immigration Minister Brent Simonette warned employers that they had the remainder of that week to send all illegal workers home. With the Immigration Minister placing emphasis on employers and no clear communication on planned increases in immigration enforcement, our news visited a few shantytowns to find out if anything changed.
The ones who did speak to us, of course, told us that not much has changed since the new year. They say the application process at the Department of Immigration is still a challenging one.
People telling me around that nothing really changed. Not like immigration come and try to
lock up people.
Right, no, not really.
No.
Among the few people willing to speak with our news on camera were Maria and Millian Simeon. The married couple, farmers by trade, have lived in the Bahamas since the 1970s and have had permanent residency since 1998. They, like many Haitians living in the Bahamas we spoke with, aren't too bothered by deadlines and threats. As a matter of fact, the Simeons say all of their associates are legally residing in the Bahamas.
All people I know live in and back there. All sweet.
All
sweet. All that we think we met. That get signed, that get residence permanent, I know all sweet.
Simeon's husband, Millian Simeon, eagerly showed us his national insurance card.
That, permanent residence, 1998. I get it. I applied for that in 1987. I got 1998.
11 years.
Yeah, same day.
It took 11 years.
Same year.
For many, waiting 11 years for approval isn't a viable option, especially with a long-gone deadline for them to acquire the correct documents. Reporting for R News, I'm Jared Higgs.
More than 4 months after Hurricane Irma left Ragged Island virtually unlivable, Member of Parliament for the devastated island Chester Cooper says the situation is still critical. Cooper says power supply was only recently restored and residents are forced to go without some essential services. He called on the government to act now. Jasmine Brown reports.
Months after the storm has passed, Cooper says the situation in Ragged Island is still critical.
So this is a critical situation, and we're calling on the government to respond appropriately. Not tomorrow, today.
Ragged Island was deemed uninhabitable following the passage of Hurricane Irma, which destroyed homes, downed power lines, killed animals, and severely damaged the island's school, clinic, and administrator's office. Days after the storm, Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis declared that the destruction wrought by Irma rendered it uninhabitable and urged residents to evacuate. The Minnis administration pledged to rebuild Ragged Island as a green city. However, Cooper says 4 months later, the storm-ravaged island still lacks key resources as public buildings remain in ruins. Cooper says while they know it will not be an overnight fix, more should and could be done by the Minnis administration.
More can be done in terms of the government buildings. There is still no police service in Ragged Island, no medical service, no nurse, no administration building, no school, and no plan as to when these issues are going to be addressed. What we would like from the government is a focus on restoring the essential services to Ragged Island. Ragged Islands are Bahamians too. They live there. They fish, they do construction, and someone will get hurt, and there won't be a nurse to apply a Band-Aid.
Last month, Minister of Public Works Desmond Bannister revealed it would cost tens of millions of dollars to rebuild Ragged Island into the green city the Minnis administration has promised. When pressed for a timeline on the rebuilding efforts, Bannister could not say. Today, Cooper insisted it is inexcusable that after all this time, impacted residents have yet to hear anything about the so-called green plan.
The one thing that we await is an explanation from the government as to what their green city is about. We haven't heard any conversation about it. We don't know exactly what the plan is. The residents of Ragged Island would like to hear more about it, and the general public would like to know the status.
Despite the many setbacks and issues following Irma, Cooper says there is one silver lining. The people of Ragged Island have remained resilient. Reporting for R News, I'm Jasmine Brown.
An audit into the Ministry of Education is set to be completed and handed over to officials in just a matter of weeks. Education Minister Jeffrey Lloyd says he's interested to see the findings and for Bahamians to finally know how their money has been spent in the education front over the past few years.
I think the people should be interested. After all, you're talking about the folks' money. And we want to know how that money, how those resources have been expended.
The audit is expected to include just about everything, including contractual relationships at the ministry, how student loans were handled, as well as other major components of the education system.
Not only in the ministry proper, but an audit of the education loan division, which is now presently being initiated, and other areas of the ministry, so that we can be accountable to the Bahamian people who expend well over $300 million for education and who deserve a response that is both timely and accurate.
Back in November, Lloyd said the audit would be made public in short order and that changes will come about as a result of the exercise. Today, while speaking to our news team on the sidelines of the National Examination Awards ceremony, the minister acknowledged there are some major shortcomings within the public education system.
There's no question that there is, you know, several gaps in our system, whether it's a shortage of teachers, shortage of material supplies, equipment. There's no question that we have a number of schools that need to be replaced and repaired. So we need to understand, you know, exactly with that we have had over the years. Again, $300+ million. How best have we been the stewards of that resource?
There were over 6,000 students who sat the BGCSEs last year. According to Lloyd, less than half received a passing grade. But he said the education system is still working, pointing to the many students honored during today's ceremony. But Lloyd still notes there are a lot of changes that need to take place, like the way students learn and placing some in same-gender settings.
There are some students who fit better in a single-gender classroom or school. There are those who are more suited to what we consider to be technical vocational education. There are those who are intellectually challenged. Others who are vocationally challenged, attitudinally challenged. There are those who are disabled. Every child has a right to a quality education.
We will have more from the National Examination Awards later on in tonight's newscast. Still to come on our news, the PLP joins CARICOM in condemning Donald Trump's disparaging comments. Plus, Arawak Port Development goes green. The details are after this break.